Good evening and welcome to the 16th episode of Nature Speaks, brought to you by Himalayan Nature. We have with us Dr. Tulsi Subedi sir, Director of Himalayan Nature, for technical support, and I'm Aditi, your moderator for the session. So this week, we are gathered to learn more about one of the major aspects of the forest ecosystem, and that is litter decomposition. In the forest ecosystems, litterfall is an important component of the nutrient cycle that regulates the accumulation of soil organic matter and helps in conserving the overall biodiversity. Decomposition of leaf litter in the natural habitat has a major role in the biogeochemical cycling of elements in the environment as well, playing a vital part in the nutrient budget of the forest ecosystem. This nutrient recycling from plant litter also influences regeneration and growth of plants in the forest, contributing towards the faunal diversity. However, despite litter fall being a crucial part for social health and rich biodiversity, very few studies have been conducted on this matter in Nepal. Therefore, today we have with us Dr. Meena Bohra, a pioneer scientist in Nepal in the research of litter decomposition in the terrestrial ecosystem. Meena did her master's from Tribhuwan University in environmental science and was involved in Resources Himalaya as EGH coordinator, along with in Liebert as field officer for home garden project. Her specialization is mainly in nutrient dynamics and isotopic variation of decomposing litters from land use types, for which she has published several articles, including in situ litter decomposition and nutrient release from forest trees in central Himalaya, and nutrient and isotopic dynamics of litter decomposition from different land uses in North China. She was a recipient of the Chinese Academy of Sciences, the World Academy of Sciences President's Fellowship, through which she completed her PhD in ecology from University of Sciences Academy of Science, and is here with us to share some of her valuable information from her research. So, Meena, welcome to the Nature Speak series.
Namaste, everyone, and thank you very much, Aditi.
Thank you. Before I let you start, Meena, I'd like to let everyone be informed that this session is being recorded and we are also streaming live in Himalayan Nature's Facebook page. Please use the chat option for any questions you'd like to ask regarding the presentation. The chat option will be available shortly before the presentation ends, and our speaker will try to answer as many of your questions as time allows. And with that, I'd like to ask Meena to start with her presentation.
Okay, thank you very much, Aditi. So I'm going to share my screen. So is it visible, Aditi?
Yes. Yes, Meena.
Okay, thank you very much once again. Namaste and good evening, everyone. So today we are here to understand a little bit about in situ litter decomposition and nutrient dynamics in context of Nepal. And I am Meena Bohra, presenting my research from my PhD thesis. So starting with the introduction, litterfall is the largest natural source of nutrient inflow in the terrestrial ecosystem, and the inflow of nutrients in the terrestrial ecosystem is governed by a very complicated and complex process which is called litter decomposition. The decomposition process is an important ecosystem process that plays a key role in global carbon dynamics and balance, and it is also a key pathway for organic matter and nutrient transfer to soil from the above ground biomass. So it eventually maintains soil fertility in the terrestrial ecosystem and is considered crucial for the regeneration of organically bound nutrients. So here are two pictures which show the entire process of litter decomposition in a diagrammatic form. The first one is simply shows how a leaf litter, when it falls from a tree, it goes into the contact of soil surface, and the process of decomposition occur, which eventually releases the nutrients and minerals that is readily available for the roots of the plants for the growth, and also for the microorganisms that are residing in the soil. So in this way, this is the cyclic process where the entire ecosystem process is functioned by a decomposition mechanism, and it is an integral part of the ecosystem functioning. So as I mentioned earlier about the complexity of the system, so the decomposition is a complex system. It's because it is not a self-governing system. Instead, it has various factors that is responsible for governing, such as environmental condition, the litter types or the traits of the plant, and the soil biodiversity. So all these indicators or all these kind of mechanisms act together in order to continue the process, and then the ecological balance is hence sustained. So this is a very simple schematic diagram which shows the mechanism of litter decomposition. So there are basically three processes that occur, that is fast litter mass loss, then that is followed by slowing down of litter mass loss, and finally there is the stabilization of organic matter. So this is the final step where the humus layer gets accumulated in the soil surface, where the undecomposed litters are stay for the longer time in the soil surface. So as this diagram shows, when a litter falls, then the first process it undergoes is leaching of the soluble compounds, and this is the physical process where the different environmental and the microclimatic conditions act upon the fallen leaf, and then the leaching of the soluble compounds takes place. Then after that, there is a microbial colonization, and it is also the phase where the mineralization of important nutrients occurs. And then finally, there is a colonization of soil fauna, and this is the phase where the disintegration and fragmentation of the leaf takes place. And finally, it is incorporated to the soil, and this remains in the ecosystem as a humus. And the process that occurs after then is called humification. So it's very important to understand nexus between litter and the climate change, so that we can link the importance of this research in terms of ecological balance and ecosystem functioning. The change in the litter carbon pool have important implications for global carbon budget and emission, and the reduction targets and the negotiations are basically based upon these factors. So across the worldwide, litter accounts for about 5% of all the forest ecosystem carbon stock. And in 2006, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change recognized litter carbon as one of the five carbon pool in the forest ecosystem. And that was also included in the annual national greenhouse gas inventories. So since then, this has been taken into consideration, that the nutrient content, or especially the carbon sink in the litter, has important implication in the climate change as well. But because of the cost and the time required to measure the litter attributes in the ground condition, many signatories of United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change report, they estimate the litter carbon stock and stock change using default values from that is given by IPCC, and most of the countries in Europe and also in including USA, it has country-specific models. But although there are some default values that is given by IPCC and country-specific models, there was a study conducted by a group of researchers in USA where they considered almost 5,000 research articles from across the country, and they tried to compare the field-based estimates with the one that the model predicted. So what they found is, according to Domke et al. In 2016, the field-based estimates, it marked about 44% reduction in litter carbon stock nationally when compared to the country-specific model predictions in the USA. So in 1 year, this was the estimation of reduced estimates as compared to the one given by the model. So what it says is that the default values of IPCC and country-specific models, they could be the easiest way to estimate the carbon stock, but they sometimes could be overestimating. So this is a burning issue, and there are various other research that has been carried out in regard to this topic. So while talking about the research advancement and its historical background, the increased studies of the litter decomposition, it increased progressively after the development of litter bag technique, and it is traced back to 1960s. And most of the studies during this period of time, we can say those are from the European countries, because they had the long-term ecological research stations since then. During 1990s, the climate change issues, it became a burning issue, and scientists, they urged the need of understanding decomposition process, considering its central role in carbon mineralization and associated release of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. Since then, the studies of litter decomposition has been widespread, and within the time frame of 50 years, it is estimated that over 50,000 research articles have been published. And the map here shows the global scenario of litter decomposition studies, and here we can clearly see that most of the studies are confined in these areas, and the Asian part, they lack the data set. So this is the map that was from the global data set and our decomposition initiative, where they are trying to establish a global database for the decomposition studies. So these are the list here. The index given here are some of the large scale and long-term ecological research stations that have been continuously doing the studies in litter decomposition in various aspects. So I tried to find out what the national scenario is. So it was very interesting that DFIS, the Department of Forest Research, in 2015, they estimated that total carbon in Nepal forest has been estimated to be 1,054 million tons. Among the various sources, litter and debris constitutes 0.67. So at least they have considered the litter and debris constitutes in the, as the function of carbon stock. So it was quite nice to know. Among the studies in Nepal, there were few studies. I tried to source the ones which has leaf litter decomposition and the litter dynamics. So there was one research article published in the Our Nature, and the other four articles, they were conducted based on the litter decomposition process. And one of the study was done in the control system, while the rest were done in the terrestrial ecosystem. So these are some research articles I found so far, and all of them have been published in the national journals. So now moving on to my study findings and my study area. This is the area I took for my study, and it lies in the Sivapuri Nagarjuna National Park, which lies on the northern side of Kathmandu Valley, covering an area of 159 kilometers square, and is a transition zone between subtropical and temperate climates. The dominant vegetations are deciduous mixed broadleaf that is dominated by oak and the Shima castanopsis forest and the coniferous or chir pine forest. So the soil is basically loamy in the northern aspect and sandy in the southern aspect. This is the detail of some site characteristics, and the entire study area was divided into three stratas, low, middle, and high. In its elevation strata, we had three land use types: forest, shrub, land, and grassland. And since the vegetation dominance varies with the elevation, and it is very obvious in context of this wide range of elevation gradient, so we considered all the dominant vegetation that all the dominant species that lied within the specified strata. So for the methods, the litter collections for each site were conducted from January to February 2017. The collected litters were air dried for 2 weeks and then oven dried. Then we used litter bag method of size 15 centimeter by 15 centimeter, and each litter bag contained 10 gram of dry litter. The bag installation were done in such a way that for the in-situ decomposition, we were supposed to translocate we were supposed to install the litter bags in the particular area where the species lies. So we prepared altogether 18 litter bags with three replicates for each species in each study area, and intended for 6-time harvest. So there were altogether 18 litter bags prepared for each site, and it was incubated during March 2017. So the harvest time was every 2 months interval, and since we designed this experiment for 1 year, so we collected for 6 times in total. Similarly, we also collected soil samples from 0 to 10 centimeter depth, and each the soil sampling was carried out in each time of litter bag collection. For the measurement and calculation, the institute litter decomposition, we used litter bag method that was designed by Berg and Laswarski in 2005. The decay rate, for the decay rate, we use negative exponential decay model. For the percentage of dry mass remaining, there was a process and there was a formula given by Bragaza and Ekerman. Similarly, the nutrient contents of soil and litter, we use standard lab procedures, and all these analyses were carried out in the laboratory of Central Department of Botany. Similarly, nutrient release from the litter, we calculated using the formula given by Guo and Sims. And for the mean annual temperature and precipitation, since we don't have a adequate number of stations where we can get the data for each elevation gradient, and for this research purpose, we needed the values for each elevation gradient. So I used interim reanalysis database at 12.5 kilometer resolution, and then based on the daily precipitation and temperature, I calculated mean annual precipitation and mean annual temperature. So the overall finding of my research is divided into two parts. And for the first part, it is the litter decomposition and nutrient dynamics from different land use types along the elevation gradient. So this is the experimental design. As I also discussed earlier, it has three different strata: high elevation, middle elevation, and low elevation. And in each elevation, there were shrubland, grassland, and forest. So all the results that I'm going to present in this section, they are basically irrespective of the species traits. So the first one is litter mass loss, and the picture here, the figure here, this is the accumulated litter mass loss. That is the mass loss after 1 year in situ litter decomposition experiment. And the figure in the downside, the three figures, it shows the bi-monthly trend of litter mass loss for different land use types. So the overall results shows that grassland had the highest rate of litter mass loss, followed by shrubland and frostland, forest. In context of different elevation gradient, the highest rate of litter decomposition was observed in low elevation, followed by middle and high elevation. We also did a three-way interaction between land use, elevation, and time, and fortunately the effect was significant for litter mass loss. So in this context, the interesting part of the result is that grassland has highest rate of decomposition, and it is quite unique, or it's different from what I observed from the study in India. And while going through some of the possible reason behind this, it is that there are various factors that is responsible for the litter decomposition process, and among them one is the photo radiation. So in the grassland ecosystem, where there is the crown coverage is very there is no crown coverage, or when it is directly the solar radiation is in direct contact to this litter bags that was laid in the grassland ecosystem, they also act as a factor that increases the rate of decomposition. So that could be one reason for this contradicting result. So for the factors affecting the decomposition, so this is the PCA plot for all the factors. I'm not sure if it's visible there, but most of all of them are the litter, initial litter nutrients, like litter phosphorus, litter potassium, litter carbon, litter CN ratio, and litter nitrogen. So among all these variables, the little nitrogen, nitrogen to phosphorus and carbon to phosphorus, they were positively correlated, while the rest were negatively correlated with the liter mass loss. So we can say that these were the initial liter nutrients. They were particularly important in decomposition process. Similarly, the table here, this is the stepwise regression where I try to predict whether the initial liter nutrient content alone can be a significant indicator of liter decomposition. So when there was only initial liter quality, the ratio accounted for 39% of variation in the liter mass loss. But when I, in the third step, when I added the climatic variable, that is the mean annual precipitation and mean annual temperature, then the variation, it increased to 46%. So this is also an indication that the initial liter quality along with the climatic variable plays an important role in decomposition process. So now the nutrient dynamics and release for each elevation and the land use is here as given in the table. And those which had negative values is highlighted in the red. And the negative values is the reflection of retention of the respective nutrients. That means those which are in the positive, those were the release, but those which are retained by the liter bags or the liter inside the bag, they are in the negative values. So most of the them are phosphorus. So phosphorus in the middle, forest, shrubland in the middle, elevation and grassland in the middle elevation, and also shrubland in the high elevation. They showed the retention capacity where the rest of the nutrients were released. So the change in the liter nutrient over time was significant, and the nutrient release followed the pattern as potassium was highly released nutrient, followed by carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus. And among the land use types, it was grassland and shrubland and forest. And if we compare this pattern with the liter mass loss, so they complement with each other. The highest liter the mass loss by the grassland is also shown by is followed by the highest rate of the nutrient release by the same ecosystem. So the P retention in shrubland and grassland at the middle and high elevation, and shrubland at the high elevation, this is because of the it is mainly credited for the solubility nature of the phosphorus and its recalcitrant effect with the soil surface. So difference in the nutrient release from the liter type, it could be attributed to the drivers of microbial colonization, resulting in the mineralization and immobilization. The release rate of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium were highest for the grassland in the middle and in the high elevation. So the pattern of nutrient release is quite obvious that potassium is the highest released because it has a loose ionic bond and it is highly mobile in the nature. So this is quite expected result in this case. So from this, the main findings are that the rate of decomposition varies substantially among the liters, that is among the land use types from functionally dissimilar vegetation. The initial liter quality along with the mean annual precipitation and mean annual temperature were the best predictors of liter mass loss. And the slow release of nitrogen and retention of phosphorus in the residual liter could be the function of microbial retention, which makes the land use types, especially in middle and higher elevation, the potential store of nitrogen and phosphorus. So we could also conclude that the ecosystems or the land use types are in the nutrient conservative mode. So for the second part of the result, it is about liter decomposition and nutrient release from the dominant tree species. So here we are studying about the specific tree species and their significance in the nutrient release and decomposition process. So for the species selection, we consider the dominant species in the given strata or the specified strata, and then another species selection criteria is based on the ecological significance. For example, in the Atlas nepalensis, which was dominant in the lower elevation, ecologically significant in erosion control. Castanopsis is harvested locally for food and source of materials, or as also as a fuel crop. Similarly, Engelhardia and Quercus, they have paleobotanic significance, and the species above 2000 meter above sea level are native to Himalaya, and they are considered the ecological and have hydroclimatic significance due to regulation of water balance and the weather dynamics. So for this particular research, there was a difference of 200 meter elevation, and in its 200 meter elevation we had a different dominant vegetation and dominant trees which we took into consideration. So altogether there were 9 species in the 7 different elevation gradient. So coming to the litter mass loss, species wise litter mass loss. So the first figure here in the left, it shows the accumulated litter mass loss, and the second figure in the right side is the bi-monthly trend of litter mass loss. The letters D and E refers to deciduous and evergreen species. So from this, what we understand is that litter decomposition followed an exponential decay pattern. The decomposition rate that ranged from 0.5 per year for pinus, which is the lowest, to 1.42 per year for ulnus, which is the highest one. So the species requirement of 0.5 to 1.3 years for 50% litter decay, and 3.6 to 4.4 years for 95% litter decay were observed. And then the litter mass loss was highest for ulnus, and it was lowest for pinus, and the deciduous had the highest rate of decomposition as compared to the evergreen. And it is also credited to the kind of adaptation capacity the two different kinds of vegetation has, because deciduous plant, they provide favorable condition for the microbial colonization, and they are adapted in such a way that their leaf litter gets easily decomposed, while the evergreen species, they have the nutrient conservative mode, and they are adapted in such a way that they need to conserve the nutrient for longer term. And for the factors affecting decomposition, here is the table, which is again the stepwise regression analysis, and this also shows that the initial litter nutrient content along with the climatic factors are responsible for the litter mass loss, and this is just based upon the initial litter nutrient content. And the one here is the partial least square analysis. The first one in the left hand side is for the plant nutrient content, and the one in the right hand side is for the soil. And the reason for comparing this result is that we also wanted to know throughout the this stepwise regression is entirely for the initial content of the litter, but throughout the decomposition phase we had all the data for soil and the litter as well. So we wanted to trace the different phases of nutrient dynamics and how they impact the litter mass loss. So these two are based on the entire temporal trend of the nutrient dynamics throughout the decomposition process. So here the VIP values gives the VIP value of 0.8 was considered as the threshold value. So all the plots that exceeds this 0.8 value, they were considered significant. And the one here, downward facing resembles the withholding variables, while the upward facing this graph shows the accelerating variables. So in this way, the initial litter nutrients and particularly weather factors control the litter decomposition. We also correlated the litter mass loss with some topographical variables such as elevation and slope, and both had a negative correlation, and it was significant. And this shows that elevation and slope both had negative impact in the litter mass loss. For each trees, the species regulate substrate quality and the environmental factors, which in turn affect the decomposition reaction. In context of different liter nutrient content, liter nitrogen, potassium, and the ratios such as carbon is to phosphorus, nitrogen is to phosphorus, nitrogen is to potassium, and phosphorus is to potassium, as well as the precipitation were the promoters, while carbon, phosphorus, CN ratio, CK ratio, and temperature were suppressors for the liter mass loss. So if we if we look at the soil parameters, the phosphorus was the only significant withholding variable, while soil carbon and pH were enhancing variables associated with the liter mass loss. So now the nutrient dynamics. Again, here there are two figures. The first one in the left side, it is the overall nutrient release or the release, nutrient release by the residual liter by the end of a year-long experiment. And the one in the right side, it shows the temporal trend of nutrient release. The order of nutrient release rate was such that phosphorus was the highest released nutrient, followed by potassium, carbon, and nitrogen. The release of nitrogen from the residual liter ranged from 66 to 16%, and it is a wide range. The phosphorus release ranged from 91 to 70%. Similarly, potassium was released at the range of 84 to 42%, and carbon release ranged from 67 to 48%. So here the rapid release of phosphorus and potassium nutrient is likely due to rapid loss of water soluble compounds of the metabolic enzyme system in the plant sap, where phosphorus and potassium are the major constituents. So this could be the reason for this peculiar result, because in most of the studies, potassium is the highest release nutrients, but in case of ours, we found the phosphorus to be the highest released nutrient. So the one nitrogen has been the least released nutrient in case of our study, both in the land use level and also in the species level. And it could be that nitrogen accumulation by residual liter could be from the soil substrate that could be related to the growth of the fungal hyphae, because generally they form a recalcitrant. There is a complex formation of recalcitrant material which accumulates nitrogen. So this could be the reason for behind the accumulation of the nitrogen, or the least release pattern of nitrogen during the decomposition period. So to find out what the 40% liter mass loss could have effect on the release of respective nutrients from the from all the species, this is a plot, linear plot, and it shows that about 40% of the initial liter mass loss corresponded to the release and retain of about 50% phosphorus, 40% potassium and carbon, and only 18% of the nitrogen. So we can see that I think I forgot to explain. So in context of phosphorus, there is a negative value, and this negative value resembles the retain of phosphorus by the a liter by the end of the decomposition process. So what we conclude from this research is that the variation among species is closely linked to adaptive strategies, where conifers produce resource conserving needle with long lifespan, while resource demanding deciduous trees produce broad leaves with short lifespan. The mean annual precipitation and mean annual temperature, together with the initial liter nutrient, could significantly predict almost 80% of the decomposition rate. This indicates the active role of climate in the liter decomposition of the studied forest ecosystem. The soil nitrogen and carbon contents increased the rate of decomposition, and the elemental change during decomposition showed that nitrogen was the least release nutrient, suggesting that liter could act as a nitrogen stock and have implications for the nitrogen turnover in forest ecosystem under a future warming climate in Himalaya. The rapid release of other nutrients such as phosphorus, potassium and carbon that points out on the liter that could act as a potential source of phosphorus, potassium and carbon. There were certain limitations and challenges while conducting this research. We could not conduct the measurement of lignin, cellulose, and hemicellulose, which are very critical and considered to be important factors for decomposition. And this is partly because of lack of time and lab facility, and also initially my intention was I wanted to compare the little nutrient with the isotopic variation, which was not possible because I could not get the samples. I could not carry the samples to China to conduct this the isotopic analysis, and the analysis is not possible in context of Nepal. Thus the regulation. We have the national regulation because it lies in the protected area. So I was forbidden to take the samples. The decomposition studies generally above 2.5 years are considered a good ecological indicator. Hence, this study could only serve as a baseline, but it could also be an important source of information for the future research process. Till now, the country, we don't have a long-term ecological research station for the continuation of study, and this is a huge challenge lying behind. So there are some way forward in my point of view. So more studies are needed in order to validate the soil chemistry, that soil chemistry is significant determinant of litter chemistry or vice versa. In fact, I feel like all the nutrient dynamics and all the litter mass loss and all the parameters that I have carried out, it needs validation. So the other studies, if conducted in the future, it could be very interesting and informative. The future studies with longer term decomposition experiments are needed to monitor nutrient turnover in the framework of global change, as the Himalayas are sensitive hotspots to global climate change. As I mentioned, the estimation of carbon stock is questionable, so the field-based analysis and field-based data could be a good source of information to trace out the global climate change, and being a very sensitive hotspot, the Himalayas, I think we should take it seriously. So at the present context, since we have very limited research going on, litter fall estimation across the forest ecosystem alone in the country, it could also be a great source of information and a great initiative to start with. So I'm almost at the end of my presentation. So I would like to thank my professor Sun Seung Woo, and also Professor Dr. Ram Kailash Yadav, two students who helped me throughout my research, Mr. Keshav Acharya and Ms. Sabana Parveen from Central Department of Botany. I am also equally thankful to CASTWAS President Fellowship, and this research was funded by National Key Research and Development Program of China and Sino-African Joint Research Projects. And finally, I would like to thank all my friends who helped me throughout my research and also throughout my phase of PhD, and family, and at last I would like to thank Himalayan Nature for providing me this opportunity, because this is very underrated and least addressed issue, and your platform is very important for me, and thank you very much for providing this platform. Thank you
Mina, for this very informative presentation. It might have been a bit too technical for some people, but we do have questions from our audience. So we have our first question from Top Khatriji, and he asks, did you examine whether chemical composition of litter had any effect on the decomposition pattern and rate?
Can you?
Did you examine whether chemical composition of litter had any effect on the decomposition pattern and rate?
No. Actually, I didn't do analyze the effect of particular chemical, but I just try to determine what kind of effect the nutrient content of the soil as well as the plant litter has on the decomposition process. Okay. So yeah, I could not address that.
Another question from Himsagar sir, and he wants to know, is there a possibility of using leaf litter to generate biogas for a sustained period, like the gobergas plant we use primarily in the lowland?
Yeah, I think it has a huge potential, and I have found some of the studies from the Europe that I mentioned. There had been some long-term research activities or long-term research stations that they have. So they have tried this to generate biogas out of the decomposed leaf litter materials, and yeah, I think it's possible, but we have to estimate the exact amount and what kind of decomposition materials we put in. And yeah, after certain processing, I think it has a good potential.
Okay.
And there have been some initiatives also.
Okay, we have two questions from Jivan Rai. He asks, do you have any particular localities for long-term ecological research stations? And with climate change happening, will there be any significant impact in litter decomposition of our country in the near future?
Yeah, for the first question, like he is asking if I have if I can name some of the potential area, right, for the long-term research. So for now, because I studied in the Sivapuri Nagarjuna National Park, I think it can be a very good demo site for all kind of ecological research activities if we could conduct that one. And I'm looking forward if I can do in the same line in the coming days. And the next question is about climate change. Yeah, because now we are so much giving emphasis to the red plus and carbon stock measurements. It has been fun giving lots of fun to our countries, and I think the carbon estimates and carbon stock estimates have always used the debris and litter fall in some way or other around. So of course it has very it has a very important role in carbon cycle and carbon emission. So in that context, yes, we are in the, and also being a biodiversity rich country, such kind of estimation could eventually give some idea about how the climate change is going to impact in the near future in context of forest ecosystem.
Thank you. Another question from Bhogendra Rai Majiji. He's asking if you have done any studies about conifer leaf litters.
Yeah, here also we had Pinus roxburghi. That is the only conifer leaf litter that was in along the site that I have chosen to study. Yes, it was done there.
Okay. Thank you. We have another question from Mohan Devkotaji, and he's asking, what are the major challenges during the study that you faced?
Thank you, Madan sir. There were so many challenges. The first one is initially we designed the replicator 4. So we also, we prepared the litter bags of 4 replicates for each site. And there was also one more land use types that was cropland, because we have that fragmented ecosystem types in when we start from, because we started our study from Sundarizal to the top of the Sivapuri mountain. So along the midway, there is also some settlement and some cropland. So we thought it would be interesting if we compare the cropland from the baseline with the middle elevation. And we also prepared the liters of out of maize to install in those areas, but whenever we did it for 2 times, we lost the litter bags for both the times. So then we had to quit that idea of comparing the litters for cropland. And the other was there was one site where the boar it dug into entire shrubland area, so we lost the litter bags over there. So these were some of the challenges, and other challenges and limitations that I already mentioned. I had intended to take the litter and the soil samples to China to conduct isotopic analysis, and initially we had a talk that maybe we could get some permission to conduct such kind of analysis, including microbial analysis, but we could not do that because the policy didn't change over time. So those were some of the challenges.
Thank you. I have a question actually, because this is such a new and interesting topic to me. It's something out of your study's findings actually. I wanted to know how similar studies could contribute in terms of forest conservation in Nepal.
So directly, I think that's why also this is very underrated topic, you know, because we can't directly link with the conservation aspect. Mm-hmm. And in most of the cases, when the pile of leaf litter gets when the leaf litter gets piled up in the forest floor, it is considered as a threat because of the forest fire, because it has high potential of forest fire if not managed properly. And the climate change and the hot year is creating more problems with that. So I can't say that it has direct contribution to the conservation, but if it is managed properly and if we took look in the perspective of the ecological balance and ecosystem balance, then yes, it has a very important role in maintaining a healthy forest ecosystem.
Okay. Thank you. We really hope that we do have other similar studies, and it really contributes to the forest ecosystem as well in the future. And that was the end of our Q&A session. Thank you, Mina, for answering the questions. And thank you to the audience for participating in this session. So we've almost come to the end of the program. Before we finish, may I ask you, Mina, to give any final remarks?
Though it is not so much popular topic, but it was very nice to have this presentation in this platform, and thank you very much, Aditi, and also Tulsi sir for providing me this platform, and thank you very much. Good evening, everyone.
Thank you, Mina, for joining us and sharing such valuable information from your research, and especially increasing the communication on litter fall for the forest ecosystem. I'd like to thank our audience as well. I hope it has been an informative evening for everyone. For those who joined us a bit late, I'd like to inform you that the session was recorded and will be available on the Himalayan Nature's YouTube channel and Facebook page, along with many other previous episodes as well, so you can view them at your convenience. So each week we have been doing these sessions to explore different aspects of nature, and we will be back with yet another interesting topic next week. So please do follow the Himalayan Nature's page to find out more about it. And with that, we've come to the end of the session. On behalf of the team, I'd like to thank our speaker, Dr. Mina Bohra, and our audience again for being with us today. And I wish everybody a good evening and namaste.